Good evening, everyone. My name is Andrew Fracknoy. I'm the astronomy instructor here at Foothill College in Silicon Valley, and I'm delighted to welcome all of you here in the Smithwick Auditorium and all of you watching at home on the web to this very special lecture in the 15th annual Silicon Valley Astronomy Lectures. These are popular lectures offered free at Foothill College thanks to the sponsorship of four organizations: the NASA Ames Research Center, the Foothill College Astronomy Program, the Astronomical Society of the Pacific, and the SETI, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence Institute. And we thank all of them for the support of this series. Tonight, we are absolutely delighted to have with us as our speaker, Dr. Ed Lu. Dr. Lu is the CEO and co-founder of the Sentinel Mission, which he'll tell you more about, and was co-founder of the nonprofit B612 Foundation, named after something in one of my favorite children's stories. It's the foundation that's raising funds for the very exciting Sentinel mission that he will describe. Dr. Lu, a physicist with a PhD from Stanford, was selected for the NASA Astronaut Corps in 1994. He flew two space shuttle missions in 1997 and 2000, including a six-hour spacewalk. And he spent a total of 185 days in space aboard the International Space Station in 2003. He is the recipient of NASA's highest honor, the Distinguished Service Medal, and worked for a time on Google's Advanced Project team and at Liquid Robotics. He has been one of the great explorers and thinkers of our time, and he is very inspired and I think a little scared, like many of us, about the whole prospect of asteroids that might cross the Earth's orbit. So here to tell you all about the Sentinel mission, finding the asteroid headed for Earth, it is my pleasure and privilege to present to you Dr. Ed Lu.
Thanks, Andrew. I want to tell you why, in particular to you, Andrew, this is something that you may be able to use in your class, one of your classes, why astronomy may be the most important subject on Earth today. And I'd like to make my case for that. So, why am I here? Well, I did have the extraordinary privilege of spending in 2003 about 6 months circling the Earth. Grand total about 3,300 orbits of Earth over three missions, watching the Earth from space. Sort of a typical view that, this is one of my favorite pictures that I took on the space station. It's a typical view that you get as you go around the Earth 16 times a day. You see not only the sunrise 16 times a day, but you see the moonrise or moonset, okay? And so you stare at this over and over and over and over again. And you look at the craters on the moon, and then you look at the Earth, and you look at the craters on the moon, and you say to yourself, what's different here? Okay. Well, the answer is the Earth has an atmosphere, which keeps many of the smaller asteroids from actually hitting the ground. But the bigger craters, you realize that there has to be just as many of them on Earth as the moon. In fact, there's actually more on Earth than there is on the moon because the Earth has stronger gravities, larger, and so on. So Earth has actually more large craters than the moon. So you come to this realization after many months of looking at this scene that, hey, you know what? It's kind of amazing that we are actually here today on this planet, given the pounding that it takes. In fact, you could even argue that the reason we're here is because of a large asteroid, as you all know. And asteroids wiped out the dinosaurs, which led to the rise of mammals, which led to us. So in some sense, we actually owe our existence here sitting in this auditorium to the fact that a large asteroid hit the Earth. Otherwise, there'd be reptilian people here and a reptilian Andrew introducing me. So let's look around the Earth. How often do these things really hit the Earth? There's a couple of big points that I want you to understand, and I want you to be able to take home and tell other people. Most people are under the mistaken assumption that asteroid impacts are very rare, okay? The reason they are under that assumption is they think, well, 65 million years ago, that's when the dinosaurs were wiped out, that's the last asteroid impact. You have to realize that asteroids come in all different sizes, from big to small. The one that wiped out the dinosaurs, very big. Wiped out nearly everything on Earth, 90% of all species on Earth were gone the next day, okay? But smaller asteroids, something even, you know, half the size of this room is enough to take out a city, as it turns out. Because, as many of you, and who here is taking physics? Who here is a student here? Okay, what's the formula for energy, for kinetic energy? 1/2 mv². Okay, so v is velocity. The faster something moves, the more energy it has. These asteroids are moving fast, and v squared is really big. So here's two asteroid impacts on Earth. This one's in Meteor Crater in Arizona, neat place. It's about the size of the financial district of San Francisco, and it's about as big as the Transamerica building, as deep. And it's created by an asteroid that from here to maybe halfway across this auditorium, okay, moving at about 40,000 miles an hour. On the right, on June 30th, 1908, an asteroid a little bit bigger, roughly the size of this room, impacted in a place called Tunguska. And its explosion had an energy of about 500 times the energy of the bomb dropped over Hiroshima. So 500 Hiroshima bombs all set off at once. It took out an area roughly the size of the San Francisco Bay Area. Okay, so we're talking 1,000 mile an hour winds knocking over the trees out to many, many miles, you know, 30 miles out. So if you took an area from Marin County to here and drew a big circle, everything in that circle would be obliterated. And that's what you can still see today in Tunguska. It's been 105 years since that day. Many of you may know that on February 15th, 2 years ago, a smaller asteroid, roughly the size of the one that hit in Meteor Crater, came in at a grazing angle over the Russian city of Chelyabinsk. That's a picture of the asteroid coming in the upper left, taken from a dashboard camera in Russia. Dashboard cameras are very ubiquitous in Russia because of insurance fraud, believe it or not. And so there turned out to be many, many images of this thing for people driving to work that morning. Well, that asteroid exploded over the city, destroyed about 100,000 windows, damaged over 1,000 buildings. And, you know, this in the middle is an example of a building that actually caved in due to just the shock wave. No pieces from the ground caused any of this damage. It was a shock wave that caused all of this. Sent about 1,000 people to the hospital. Okay, had an energy of about 0.5 megaton of TNT, or about 15 times the size of the bomb dropped over Hiroshima. Luckily, it was not that close to the city. Otherwise, things would have been much, much, much worse. So let's talk about how rare asteroids are. It turns out that around the world, we have a network of sensors set up by an organization called the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Organization. Okay? This is all the nations around the world who agree we are not going to set off nuclear weapons in the atmosphere. And the way we monitor it to make sure that these nations, nobody's breaking the rule, is that we actually set up these large listening stations all around the world. They're called infrasound stations. Okay? It turns out that a nuclear explosion is so loud that you can hear it from 1,000 miles away or more. Okay? So if you have multiple stations around the world and somebody sets off a nuclear weapon, you can hear it from multiple stations. I can figure out by triangulating where it came from and how big it was. Okay? So this network has been operational for quite some time. And does anybody know how many times it has ever detected a nuclear weapon explosion in the atmosphere? Zero is the answer. But something sets off the network about every couple months. What might that be? Asteroid impacts is what they are. They are asteroid explosions in the atmosphere. So let me show you what that looks like. This data was recently declassified, and the data was released showing the locations of the asteroid impacts around the world between the years 2000 and 2013. So this is just a little over a decade, okay? And we'll show you where all these things are, and we'll color code them so you can see them by size. What we're gonna do is show you three colors, white, yellow, and red, okay? White is between 1 and 10 kilotons of TNT. Yellow is between 10 and 20, which, for reference, the Hiroshima bomb would have been a yellow. That's 15 kilotons. The red is much larger. Okay, so what's going on here? Random places around the world are having explosions. Let this sink in a little bit. This is only a little over a decade's worth of data. Okay, now, most of these explosions happened too high in the atmosphere to cause too much damage on the ground. But they tell you that these impacts really aren't rare. The big ones are actually large enough to cause damage on the ground, as I showed you in that previous slide from February 15th of just 2 years ago. That was a big one. That one was in Northern California, which we actually heard at our house, which is only about 5 miles from here. I remember we actually thought our two little kids here were doing something upstairs, and we heard this loud noise. It was the sonic boom from that. So let me pass this down. Okay, for all you physics geeks, and this being an astronomy lecture, there's got to be some physics geeks here. I like to show this because this is the actual data of number of asteroids versus their size. So it turns out that there are many more small asteroids than large asteroids. The one on the far right it says Chicxulub. That's the crater. It's the remnant of the asteroid that killed off the dinosaurs. Tunguska is the one in 1908. Chelyabinsk is the one that happened February 15th, 2 years ago. What it basically means is what we do is we can count those infrasound impacts, we can count craters on the moon, and we can look up in the sky and see asteroids out there circling around the sun, just like the Earth. And you can count them up, and using all three independent means, you can calculate how many asteroids are out there and how often they hit. Now, because there's three independent ways of doing this, you know, data on the ground, counting craters on the moon, or just looking out there with telescopes, they all agree. So that's why we have a really good idea of how often these things hit. So, lesson number one. Asteroid impacts are not rare. The next time somebody tells you that, you say, that's just wrong, okay? And you saw that in the video, okay? An asteroid large enough to destroy a city hits the Earth roughly every 100 years or so, okay? So meaning large enough to destroy a city, I'm talking something that would be the size of one of our largest nuclear weapons. Not a small nuclear weapon, but a large nuclear weapon. 100 to 500 times the size of the bomb dropped over Hiroshima. Okay, and it's random. So, let me ask you a question. What is keeping us from losing a city right now, or worse? It's like, we're lucky. Most days we're lucky, right? Because these things arrive, and that's kind of random. Most of the Earth is not populated by cities. Most of the Earth is water. And most of the rest of its land is actually desert or unpopulated. So, most days we get lucky, right? But let me ask you, is luck a great strategy in the long term, right? You know, there's an entire city built on the premise that you cannot beat the house, right? Las Vegas, you know, we were just there as a family, and we talked about how these really, really nice casinos are, you know, who paid for those casinos, right? Well, the law of large numbers paid for those casinos, because you cannot beat the house forever. You cannot play any game of luck forever and win forever. Right? So the real question is, when is the next one going to hit? Okay? And depending upon the size, we actually have an idea. All right? For the very largest of something larger than, say, all the bombs dropped in World War II. In your lifetime, there's about a 1% chance that that's going to happen. It's not that big. It's not that small either. Okay? In your lifetime, what are the chances that we're going to see a nuclear weapon-sized impact? Already one, because there was one 2 years ago, okay? Will you see another one? You got odds on chance that yes is the answer. Will it hit an unpopulated area? Hopefully. This is just one of my favorite Gary Larson cartoons. You all know about the impact that wiped out the dinosaurs and why we know that's true, right? There's a crater, it's over 100 miles across, that caused, and you can see the remnants of all the roughly million cubic miles of rock thrown out by that, which scattered around the Earth, leaving a layer called the KT boundary. It was a mystery for a long time why there is this layer of rock worldwide And dinosaur fossils below it and no dinosaur fossils above it. Okay, this was figured out in the mid-1980s by Louis Alvarez and his son, Walter, from Berkeley. Okay, so there's three steps to protecting the Earth from being hit by an asteroid. And hopefully I've convinced you that somewhere, somebody ought to be thinking about this problem. Okay, there are three steps. And I'm going to work backwards from step number three. And I'm going to try and show you that, in fact, what you may think as being the difficult part is, in fact, almost the trivial part. The three steps in order with number three is the actual deflecting of the asteroid. Who here saw Armageddon, world's greatest movie? Right? Okay. Who here believes any of the physics in that movie? Okay, if so, you should leave. The biggest misconception I run into is people think that it's actually very, very difficult to deflect an asteroid from hitting the Earth. That's the easy part. This part is mostly solved. We haven't done it for real because, well, we haven't had to do it yet, but I'll explain why. But I'm going to hopefully convince you that this is not the issue. Okay, we know how to deflect asteroids. How do you do that? Well, if you can find an asteroid decades before it hits the Earth, when it is still many billions of miles from hitting the Earth, because remember, the incoming speeds are like 30, 40,000 miles an hour, you don't have to change its speed very much in order to make it hit the Earth. So let's think about this. The Earth is going around the sun, right? It's like running around a racetrack. Anybody ever been to a demolition derby? You have two cars driving around to two different rings, right? And as long as they go through it at different times, it's okay. But if you get to the intersection at the same time, there's a collision. So you can think of the Earth as being one car in a demolition derby, and that asteroid going around its circle as being another car, okay? And it's like an intersection without a stoplight, right? As long as you're not there at the same time as the other car, it's actually okay, right? So the real trick to getting an asteroid to miss the Earth is if 10 years from now I can make it show up to that intersection when the Earth is not there, because the Earth is a moving target. At this very moment, we are traveling around the sun at about 65,000 miles an hour. The Earth is 8,000 miles across, and that means that the Earth actually travels a distance equal to its size in 7.5 minutes. So if you were trying to hit the Earth, and you took your shot 3 minutes early or 3 minutes late, guess what? You missed the Earth. It's not in the intersection when you get there, right? So the real goal is to prevent an asteroid 20 years from now from going through the intersection where the Earth is 3 minutes early or 3 minutes late. That's all you got to do. So when you throw those numbers into it and actually do the full calculations, you find that you only really need to change the speed of an asteroid by about a millimeter per second, or a couple of millimeters per second. Okay, and just for reference, if you go outside and you look at the speed that an ant crawls, maybe roughly the speed that a snail crawls, depending on if it's a fast snail, that's about a millimeter per second. Okay. So if I can take an asteroid which is moving around the sun at 65,000 miles an hour and change it by that much, the speed that an ant crawls, I can make it miss the Earth. Okay? You don't need Bruce Willis. You don't need oil drillers. Okay? You don't need nuclear weapons in general. Okay? You need to change its speed by a millimeter per second. Okay? How do you do that? Well, simplest thing you can do is just run into it. Right? Take a spacecraft size of this podium and run into it, right? It's like playing billiards. Even if that rock happens to be the size of this room, if this thing's moving fast enough, it's going to change the speed, right? Turns out we've already done that. We flew a mission called Deep Impact in 2005, ran into a comet, slightly different thing, but the principle's the same. And this is video taken from the spacecraft. There's two halves of the spacecraft just before it runs into that comet, creating a big crater and actually changing its speed, right? It actually hit the thing at about 10 kilometers per second, so it was a bit of careful aiming involved there. This is what the video looks like from the other half of the spacecraft, which veered off to the side and took photos as that other one hit. That's all you got to do. We've done this before, okay? We can deflect asteroids. If you really want to get crazy, you can do things, something called a gravity tractor. It's an idea myself and a colleague came up with. That's a big rotating asteroid. You can take a small spacecraft, hover nearby, and use gravity to tow that asteroid by a tiny, tiny, tiny amount. As long as your thrusters are not pointed directly at it, you can actually tow an asteroid by, you know, a fraction of a millimeter per second. So, this was all based upon us knowing that an asteroid is going to hit us. If you don't know where an asteroid is, or if you don't know it exists yet, you cannot deflect it, right? Step number three is deflecting them. Step number two is finding them first, right? I right now, can tell you how to deflect an asteroid that we know about, right? So the real problem is actually, right now, finding these asteroids out in space decades before they hit the Earth. Now, we have gotten good enough, actually mostly through NASA, has gotten good enough at predicting where things are going, measuring their speeds in space. When you know where something is, you can measure it and measure its trajectory, that we can tell you precisely where that thing is going to be decades out into the future. For instance, we have a probe heading towards Pluto right now. It was launched 14 years ago, I think, 13 years ago, okay? And even prior to that, during the many years leading up to its launch, they knew where Pluto was going to be. They knew the aim point, what they were shooting for. How did they do that? Well, it's through the power of calculus and orbital mechanics and astronomy that we have been able to calculate orbits and we know how to aim things out there in space. Okay, we can do the same thing for asteroids, but you basically need telescopes to find these asteroids. If you can't find them, there's nothing you can do. So this is what we are actually working on today. So it's like real estate, right? There's three rules for protecting the Earth from asteroids. Find them early. If you don't find those asteroids until late, when it's on its final, you know, the last couple days coming in, nothing you can do. This thing is moving too fast, it's carrying too much momentum, it's too large. There is nothing we could do. Even the very large nuclear weapon is very likely to be totally ineffective against something like that. But if you find it 20 years out, it's almost trivial, right? So the problem goes from trivial, if you got lots of warning, to almost impossible if you have no warning. So what's the best strategy, right? Use your brains and find them early, okay? So the whole game is finding asteroids early. Why is that hard? It's hard because, has anybody here ever held a meteorite? Okay, or if you go to a museum, you'll see one. There's a nice one at the California Academy of Sciences, big one. What color was it? Black, okay? About the color of a piece of charcoal, and that's actually typical for asteroids. Okay, black object out against a black background in space, okay? Those are hard to spot, right? Because there's not much light reflecting off them, right? And telescopes look out there with light. Now remember, they're also not that large, right? You know, something that we're talking about that could wipe out San Francisco is the size of this room, okay? Make it the color of charcoal and put it 30 million miles out there and good luck finding it, okay? That is exactly the issue. So how are we doing so far? Okay, I would call this a failing grade. Okay, now remember I said that asteroids come in different sizes, so this is actually a bit of a subtle trick question. If you ask, how easy is it to find those asteroids? Well, the bigger something is, the easier it is to see with a telescope, right? So the very largest asteroids are much easier to spot with telescopes. And in fact, NASA has done a fantastic job of finding the very largest of asteroids, okay? Anything larger than about half a mile across is large enough to wipe out human civilization no matter where on Earth it hits. Okay, I don't care if it hits in the middle of the Pacific Ocean or if it hits in the middle of the Sahara. Human civilization is going down the tubes, okay? And we know this pretty well because that's large enough to throw up enough dust into the atmosphere to wipe out growing seasons worldwide for a couple of years. Okay, anybody here know how much food is stockpiled on Earth? A couple of months, as it turns out, okay? So we are always dependent upon growing food someplace. If you lose growing seasons in the northern and southern hemisphere for 3 years or 4 years or 5 years, when do we run out of food? About 2 months in, okay? What happens to society 5 years later? It's not good, whatever it is, okay? And that's why it's commonly understood that anything above sort of a half mile across, you cannot let hit the Earth. And NASA was instructed by the US Congress to find all asteroids larger than that size, you know, a few thousand feet across, in the mid-90s. And they did a great job at that, because that was conceivable to do with the telescopes that existed at the time. And we have found very nearly all of those. And you know that you found them all because you know you can search the whole region of the solar system. You can see them from far enough distance to do that. Okay, so what's the problem? Well, if it's smaller than that, we haven't found most of them. The 1% is, let's say I ask, what is only the size of a nuclear weapon? Okay, turns out of those asteroids, we've only found about 1%, and that's the problem. Should we as human beings be concerned about things that might only wipe out 100 million people, or might only collapse the world economy for a few centuries, or might only take out Western Europe, or something like that, rather than killing off all of human civilization? You know, my answer is yes, okay? But we haven't been able yet to do a very good job at that, okay? We're only at really the 1% complete level, meaning if it's out there, the chances of me seeing it right now with current telescopes is about 1%, if it's larger than a nuclear weapon in impact size. Remember I showed you that image of the asteroid that hit that Russian city of Chelyabinsk 2 years ago, February 15th. Anybody know how NASA found out about that? On Twitter is the answer, okay? I think that's unacceptable, okay? As things stand today, our expected warning time of the next asteroid impact larger than a large nuclear weapon is exactly zero, just like we saw 2 years ago, right? And I think that's unacceptable. So, you can moan about things all day, or you can do something about it. We felt that we had no choice but to do something about it. So our foundation has set up a mission called the Sentinel Mission to actually try and address this problem, okay? Remember, step two, the critical step is finding asteroids first, okay? Step three, almost easy, okay? Step two is the problem, okay? How do you find these asteroids? Well, let's use a little bit of physics here. Dark object in space, okay? Light doesn't reflect off it. It's tough to see with a telescope. Dark objects in space get warmed by the sun, right? Go outside in July, put your hand on the blacktop, and you know that the sun warms black objects up quite a lot, right? When things get warm, they glow in infrared. They emit infrared light. And it turns out that the background sky is much colder than the temperature of asteroids in space. And these asteroids glow, and they turn out to be easier to spot with smaller telescopes by looking at their infrared emission rather than the light reflects off of them from the sun. The problem is that these wavelengths of infrared light don't come through the Earth's atmosphere. So if you set up a telescope like that on the ground, all you're going to look at is the Earth's atmosphere. You're going to look at clouds. You're going to look at water vapor in our atmosphere. If you want to have a telescope like that, you need to put it in space, and there's the problem. So if you want to find these things, what we are building is actually a telescope to do just that. It is an infrared space telescope. But we're going to do something a little bit different. Rather than just putting it in orbit around the Earth, let's think about where you want to put this thing, okay? Telescopes work best when they're pointed away from the sun, right? You know, like, at nighttime, you can look up in the sky and see a lot of things. Daytime, it's kind of hard to see stars, right? Because you're looking towards the sun. If you want to be able to see asteroids that cross Earth's orbit, i.e. that could hit the Earth, then I want to be between the Earth and the sun. So I want to have my back to the sun, looking away from the sun towards the Earth's orbit. And what that actually means is you want to actually be in an orbit going around the sun at about 3/4 of the way between the Earth and the sun. Okay, so it's a little more difficult than putting something into just orbit around space, but that, in fact, is what the Sentinel Telescope is. This is our project, and it is, just for scale, about the size of a FedEx moving truck. Okay, so make that into a space telescope, put in a rocket, launch it into space. That's what we're trying to do. And we intend to find the great majority of those asteroids that are yet to be discovered, so we can solve point number two. This is the telescope. It's actually based on the Kepler Space Telescope, which is the telescope that's used to find planets around other stars. What we've actually done is we've taken the main design of the body of the spacecraft, changed the optics, and changed the made it an infrared telescope, and we're going to launch that. Okay, brings the price down. Most importantly, it is being run by a private nonprofit foundation because we felt that this is a job that needs to be done. In fact, it turns out that most of the large telescopes ground-based on Earth, like that you see on mountaintops, are originally built by private nonprofit organizations. Most people don't know that. On a nice sunny day here, a nice clear day, you can look down towards South San Jose and see Lick Observatory up in the hill. That was built by a guy named James Lick. Telescopes of which the expansion of the universe was first discovered in Southern California at Mount Palomar, Andrew Carnegie. The Keck telescope, though currently the most powerful set of telescopes, the twin telescopes in the Big Island of Hawaii, as well, the Keck family, which is the Standard Oil fortune. So most large telescopes on the ground have actually been built via private donations. And we're no different, except that our telescope doesn't sit on a mountaintop, it goes into space. So let's just show you what this thing looks like in space. That's Sentinel. Again, what it's going to do is look for and track all these asteroids so that we can, on the ground, calculate their orbits. Once we can calculate their orbits, we know where they're going. We will know many, many years, decades in advance, if any of these asteroids out there is going to hit the Earth, so that you can employ the easy step, step three, you can call Bruce Willis, right? Or go run into it with a spacecraft, better yet. So this is what Sentinel's going to do. It's going to look for objects that are moving in space. Those are asteroids in general. Okay, let me show you its orbit. We'll back it off here in a second and show you what it looks like going around the sun. This is an actual simulation of actually what the sky looks like in infrared. This is actually using data from NASA's WISE telescope, which is an infrared observatory, doing astronomy. So let's take a step back and look at the big picture here. There's Sentinel right there. Okay, keep your eye on it. It gets a little dim. But we'll step back in the solar system, look at the whole solar system. The purple line is Sentinel's orbit around the sun. The light green line is Earth's orbit around the sun. Sentinel's going to go around the sun about every 8 months, and it can see the area within the white semicircle for large asteroids. And as it goes around the sun, this area sweeps around, and it will pick up all these asteroids. As it sees, when it goes within that area, we'll be able to track it. It's basically how it works. I'll skip through this. This is basically our observing scene. What you do is just look into the sky, look for objects that move, calculate their orbits. So let me show you what the real solar system looks like. This is every single known asteroid in the solar system from the NASA database. That's Earth's orbit. This is the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. All these asteroids are the ones that could hit Earth because they come in towards this area here. Okay? Remember that of these asteroids, the large ones we found. The small ones, the ones that are only nuclear weapon sized, not so good. And that's what we're... So this picture, though, in other words, is really incomplete. These are, by the way, all correctly displayed, all the orbits. So there goes the Earth. And in fact, there are a lot of them out there, but there's actually 100 times more than we've shown here. The real space has 100 times more than this. In fact, what you can do is visualize that. You can show what space really looks like with 100 times more asteroids. It really looks like this. It's a little bit misleading because the asteroids are much smaller than the pixels here, so it looks like space is completely full with them, but there is a lot of them. So what are we trying to do here? The ancients were actually correct in some weird way when they believed in astrology, that the heavens affect life here on Earth. They do affect life here on Earth, just not the way they thought, right? Actually, the problem is the pieces of the heaven actually run into the Earth. But what we're talking about doing is something kind of interesting. You know, the history of astronomy has been throughout the last several thousand years one of looking up into the sky, seeing what's happening, understanding the patterns, and predicting the future, right? That's what this here is, something called the Mayan Codex. And it was the Mayans who actually were able to understand planting seasons, when you should plant crops, when there were going to be things like eclipses and so on. This is a Arabic astrolabe, very similar thing. This is from over 1,000 years ago. It's a beautiful instrument. And if you turn the crank on it, you can tell where the motions of the planets are going to be. Okay, so back in the day, you know, 1,000 years ago, this made astronomers quite powerful. You know, that maybe they've lost some status since then, but maybe we'll bring it back. Made them powerful because they could predict things about the future. When should we plant our crops? Where is the planet Venus going? You know, those sorts of things. Very, very important to know when you should harvest, right? To the more modern day, this is the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, where we are looking at the galaxies in the universe and trying to answer the question, is the universe going to expand forever? Turns out it is, in part due, we know this due to observations from telescopes like this. And this was Sentinel. This is Sentinel's map. What it's actually doing is creating a digital three-dimensional model of the solar system. And we will know the future. We will know if any of these objects is going to hit the Earth and when. Okay, so object A is going to hit the Earth on this particular date at this place. That's the kind of warning you're going to get. What's different? What's different is that in these cases, you're just an observer. All we're doing is saying, hey, planet Venus is going to be here. All right? In this case, if you don't like what you see, you could change it, because now we have rockets. Now we have spacecraft. Now we have physics and astronomy. Okay? There's something that's fundamentally changed here. We as human beings can actually change the future of the solar system. I think that's rather amazing. And this is why I say that astronomy could be the most important subject on this planet. We don't know right now. As of right now, I can't tell you if any of these large objects is going to hit the Earth this, you know, in my lifetime. I just don't know. Neither does anybody else. Sure would like to know. So the Sentinel mission, scheduled for launch in 2019, is to do just that. This is just one of my favorite photos. It's taken from around the surface of the moon. This is actually a Japanese spacecraft looking back at Earth. It reminds me of the famous Carl Sagan quote, which is, on that pale blue dot, everyone you ever know has lived out their lives. Everyone ever you've ever met, everyone you've ever loved, everyone you've ever heard of has lived out their lives. Like it or not, for the moment, Earth is where we make our stand. Right? That's what we're really talking about. We're really talking about protecting our planet, and it's rather amazing that we can actually seriously talk about doing that. Here we are in 2019 launching. By the way, the cost of our spacecraft is roughly equivalent to the cost of building a large academic building. So, in fact, go over to Stanford, you know, my old alma mater who's always hitting me up for money, like everybody else. Anybody here is a Stanford grad, you know what it's like, right? The cost of building this telescope to find the asteroids that could hit the Earth is really the cost of a large freeway overpass or the cost of there's a new performing arts center on campus, roughly the same. It's a few $100 million. It is expensive, okay? The cost of saving the Earth is roughly the cost of building a performing arts center on a college campus, okay? So think about that. I hope that puts it into perspective. Remember I said there's three steps to protecting the Earth, right? Number three is the deflection, easy. Number two, finding the asteroids first. Hard, but we know how to do that, okay? What's number one? It's getting people to have the foresight to care, to think about this, right? Because there is very much an out of sight, out of mind kind of thing, and human beings do not historically do well at handling threats that are off in the future, okay? Human beings do very well at handling threats that we know about for sure. You know, that person's trying to kill me, hey, this plane crashed, and I have to do something about it. We're good at that, but when we're talking simply about the fact that there are odds that something is going to happen in the future, we as human beings don't do too well, right? Can we raise enough money to build our performing arts center, given that human beings aren't real great at having foresight, thinking ahead? The example I often use is the people of New Orleans. Now, the people of New Orleans in the year 2001 all knew that the next big hurricane to hit New Orleans is going to wipe them out. Okay? They all knew the levees were unsupported. Okay? And in fact, the local newspaper, the Times-Picayune, wrote a five-part series 1 year before New Orleans was destroyed, talking about what's going to happen the next time a major hurricane hits New Orleans. Did they spend any money fixing the levees? No. Okay. This is the failure of human beings to think about the future more than what's in front of their nose. Now, astronomy sort of naturally looks on longer timescales. It naturally makes people look out there. It naturally makes people look up and think big things, right? And so my feeling is that the biggest challenge is actually step one, getting people to care. Now, you don't need to change the, you're not necessarily talking about an enormous government program. You're not talking about changing the economy of the world. I'm not talking about getting a billion people to come together. I'm talking about getting enough people together to build a performing arts center. Okay? And we know that's doable, right? Or to build a museum. So a quote that I like from a very close friend of mine, Rusty Schweikart, former Apollo 9 astronaut, is that we are not passengers on spaceship Earth, we're the crew. And the real challenge here is step number one, getting people to say, you know what? Getting enough people as it takes to build a performing arts center to say, you know what? I think protecting the Earth is a noble cause that somebody somewhere ought to care about. And so really, I think that's what the Sentinel mission is all about. It is trying to get people to take this problem seriously. I don't know if you can read this. In fact, I don't think you can. This is a New Yorker cartoon where one dinosaur says to the other, all I'm saying is now is the time to develop the technology to deflect asteroids. Let's not be like these guys, right? We have a choice, right? So my plea to you is to be part of the solution. Okay, what does that mean? That means telling people about this. Taking the time to learn something about it. It's free. Go to our website, sentinelmission.org. It's fairly easy to remember, sentinelmission.org, and just sign up for the newsletter. Every couple of months, every other month, you get a notice with just interviews with people working on the problem, status of the Sentinel mission, what's going on. It's free. And just tell people about it, okay? The only way things happen in this society is when people tell other people about it and movements start, right? And so, you know, if I have an ask to you, it is to go home and just sign up for the newsletter, right? It doesn't cost you anything. If you want to donate, wonderful. We would love that. But if, you know, just learn about it, right? Be part of the solution, okay? So that's all I had for tonight. I just want to thank you for your attention. I'm happy to answer any questions about anything. So thank you.
Asteroids with relation to the orbits of the planets was a two-dimensional diagram.
Yeah, it's done using three-dimensional view, but yeah. It's
how far above and below the plane of the orbits do the asteroids go, and do they have tilted orbits that might intersect, and what would be the capability of your satellite to detect, you know, like 90 degrees above and below the plane of the orbit?
Yeah, it is a three-dimensional thing, but it is still concentrated in the plane of the solar system. So if you look at what's called the angle of inclination, which is how tilted the asteroids are from it, it is really centered around 0 degrees, meaning it's in the plane of all the planets. But it has some width to it. It's about 20, 30 degrees, so there is some width to it, all right? And that's all taken into account in our design of the spacecraft. We'll go back and forth. How about right over here?
I'll ask the question I'm sure that is on many people's minds, and that is, do we have a model of asteroid density versus size that would provide us some insight into the number of candidates we might find and the precision that would be required before launching what would undoubtedly be an expensive shot to divert one of these?
Yes. In fact, you don't. We have theoretical models for the distribution of sizes of asteroids, and they match very well the observed distribution. So better than actual the theoretical models, we actually have observed distribution. It's called what's called a power law distribution. There are, again, many more small asteroids and large asteroids with a particular shape distribution, and it's actually reasonably well measured. Now, I do want to make a point about the cost of deflecting an asteroid. While it, again, would be also roughly similar in cost to finding them, you know, a few hundred million dollars, the cost of a freeway overpass, I think raising the money to protect, let's say it's going to hit a city and it's going to wipe out a city, the cost of real estate in nearly any city, even take the poorest city you can, is overwhelmingly more than the cost of a freeway overpass. Okay? It's pretty easy to get people who live in a city to say, you know what, why don't we personally fund that mission to keep our city from being destroyed? I think that's, again, when I say that when you find an asteroid that's going to hit, it's trivial solving that problem. That, you know, money's not the issue then, right?
Mm-hmm. Hi. Can you comment on how stable those orbits are likely to be? What I mean is if there some asteroids interact with each other, for example, and deflect from what we expected the orbit to be, how much time does that really leave?
These asteroid, how stable are the asteroid orbits is the
yes.
question. And they are chaotic on about a 100-year time scale. That means about once every 100 years you need to remeasure their orbits, okay? Because all these other effects begin to add up and cause them to drift. Okay, so turns out that our ability to calculate orbits off in the future is pretty solid out to about 100 years. Then it begins to drop off, and by about 200 years, it's getting pretty bad. Okay, but that's actually that means that the next time you need to fly this mission is our great 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 grandchildren. Okay, so it's kind of nicely set up in some sense. Mm-hmm.
So if we are to deflect an asteroid, what are the impacts of that on the rest of the solar system and other, possibly creating other potential hazardous near-Earth asteroids?
Remember, empty space is mostly empty space, okay? And remember, I made the point that it looks like they're, you know, space is filled with asteroids. It is absolutely not, okay? These things are very, very small. They don't tend to hit each other very much. The average timescale between when one asteroid gets hit by another asteroid is about 100 million years. It's pretty long, okay? So a typical asteroid can fly for 100 million years before it hits anything else, okay? Unless we hit it on purpose, okay? We're going to guide something in to hit it. So the odds that you change anything and it does anything to anything else, zero. It's empty space. Empty space is empty space. And we do have tremendous precision to be able to measure things and direct things, right? Let's talk about a concrete example. The Cassini spacecraft and its lander to Titan. We targeted a moon of Saturn, okay? That's how good we can target things. And you know, we will keep things from hitting other things, basically.
Mm-hmm. Hi. Yeah, I have a couple questions about asteroids that actually hit and have struck the Earth. Mm-hmm. So most recently, the one in Northern California, do you know if that was actually reported in any kind of media outlets? Because I personally don't remember hearing anything about that.
Yeah, that's called the Sutter Mill one, and okay. Was quite big news, actually, north of Marin. And there was actually an expedition sent out there by NASA Ames to go pick up pieces of this. If you follow these sorts of things, you know, you will see, you know, local newspapers talk about, you know, explosions in the sky all the time. In fact, you know, I showed you how often these things. And basically, every time one of these things happens, the local newspapers are agog over it for a week, and then they forget about it.
Yeah. I just didn't know if there was a conscious, decision to not communicate that widely so as to not, you know, kind of alarm public about, impending doom, if you will.
No, I think the general public is perhaps more interested in, you know, the latest Hollywood scandal. Truthful.
Yeah. No,
I think people are.
Because usually you don't see it in like the mainstream media. You might see it in local newspapers or something like that, but it's not going to make like the national news or anything like that.
The impact in Chelyabinsk, you know, was front page of Wall Street Journal and the New York Times for a week. Right. Congressional hearings and everything, okay? Where they asked, NASA, and they called the head of Space Command up and said, why didn't you see this thing coming? They said, we couldn't have seen it.
Thanks.
So, you know, the bigger ones do cause repercussions. But I'd rather us have that story of us deflecting an asteroid rather than us talking about how we're going to clean up after one. You know.
Mm-hmm. I'm hoping the first part of my question is predicated on correct knowledge. But the day of the Chelyabinsk meteor explosion, wasn't there supposed to be another asteroid passing the Earth very quick, very, very near to the Earth that was previously tracked and known it was going to cross but not hit?
You are absolutely correct. There was another asteroid that day, and everybody's looking the other direction. Completely unrelated, and then we know it's unrelated because we actually know the orbits of both of these asteroids now, and they're different orbits. It's just pure chance. But by the way, you know, about every couple of months you hear about an asteroid coming, you know, very close to the Earth in the newspapers. Remember that 99% of them are undetected. So it actually happens all the time. And most of them we just don't know about. Okay, so this idea of an asteroid being a near miss, it's very, very frequent, as it turns out.
Who tracked and knew? How was that? That one was tracked and known.
That one was tracked because it was discovered early by chance. It was one of the 1% that was seen. The other 99%, Chelyabinsk was one of them, right? So the next large asteroid to hit Earth has what probability of us having a warning? About 1%. That's the way it is right now. Mm-hmm.
I'd like to ask your opinion about a different astronomical phenomena, somewhat related, called a coronal mass ejection. We know that the Carrington event occurred in 1859, wiped out a significant portion of the telegraph system on Earth, which was the only electrical system present, and that current technology would give on the order of a few hours of warning. And this to me seems like a high priority for the power grid, that they should shut things down, protect them. And yet, with a roughly decades order timescale, I don't see people making this into a priority.
Well, I think the Carrington event, you know, I can tell you that the people who run the electric grid, this is a huge fear of theirs, okay? And there is significant money being put into hardening the electrical grids for exactly that reason. This is just a totally different problem, but it is another example of something where people need to think off into the future to think about rare events that can be really bad. Totally unrelated to asteroids, obviously, so you know, I'm not arguing for or against it, right? Obviously, it needs something that needs to be done. But the interesting thing about that problem is it costs hundreds of times more to solve that problem than it does of solving the asteroid problem, because electrical power grids are very, very expensive to harden. Okay, so that's something that's going to cost a lot more money to solve. Obviously, I think we need to solve it, but it's a whole lot harder to solve that problem because it takes a whole lot more money.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
You may have already answered this, but from the earlier diagram, you know, it looks like there are millions of asteroids and things running around out there in very little space. But you say there is a lot of space, and the diagram made me wonder, how do you send a mission out to Pluto and plot the trajectory without it running into any of those?
Because it is still mostly empty space, and you know, we do this routinely. And remember that the size of a pixel is millions of times larger than the size of the actual object to scale. Okay, it really is empty space.
Mm-hmm. Kind of related to the first question about the orbital plane, I guess most of our concern is with the asteroids within the solar system. I was wondering, is there much concern at all for things outside of the solar system?
Yes, actually, a good, better example would be things from the very outer reaches of our own solar system, or comets, which are objects that don't orbit in close to the sun but come from many times outside the orbit of Pluto. Okay, they're a much harder problem to solve because where they are, they're cold, so they don't emit much infrared. You can't see them with regular telescopes very well either. And they come zooming in without much warning. Okay, they sit so far out there and they come almost straight in towards the sun. A typical comet comes almost straight in. So you would only get a few months' notice. Okay, now, I think of it as a completely different problem, the problem of solving comets. Luckily, however, asteroids comets are 100 times rarer than asteroids in terms of number. Okay, so if you could solve one of these two problems first, you would solve the asteroid problem first, because there's 99 asteroids for every one comet, okay? And right now, it's not within our technical capability. Nobody has any idea right now how you'd solve the comet problem. So let's start with the big problem first and solve that, I would say. And then, you know, maybe off in the future, our grandkids can solve the comet problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you say that asteroids' orbits are chaotic, that in the sense that every 100 years you need to remeasure them.
Yeah, which is a long time for being chaotic, but yes.
Once an asteroid is made a moderately near miss of the Earth, doesn't it orbit become chaotic instantly? Because depending on, you know, exactly how close it got to Earth, it's going to go in this or that orbit. And so maybe the ones that are moderately close to Earth should be radar reflectors. Maybe should be put on so they can be tracked very accurately.
That's exactly what we do. So in fact, you're absolutely correct that the chaotic behavior is dominated by what are called close approaches. And however, our orbital tracking is good enough, so unless it's extraordinarily close approach, meaning really grazing the planet, our tracking accuracy is good enough so that we don't actually lose it after it deflects around the planet. So it's when you get multiple close approaches, and that can happen, that things tend to, you know, it's like a double bank shot in billiards. It's difficult to do, and it's also difficult to calculate, right? Those are the ones that you need to do, and those are the ones where you would love to have radar. But the nice thing is radar is perfectly suited to finding those things that come very, very, very close to the Earth, right? Because radar has such a limited range that you can't pick things far out. But those are the ones I care about for getting radar are the ones that can actually come close enough to get radar tracking on. So.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for your talk. It's a very attractive proposal, and it sounds relatively cheap also. The large numbers involved, though, I have two questions, economic questions. There's the concept of cost per life saved, which you get in industry today. Different industries, for emotive reasons, have largely different numbers. But has anyone done a calculation that said if nothing is done about this problem, and then equate it with the cost of the project,
yes,
how cheap it is to save a life?
So first off, this concept of cost per life saved is something that works best for the type of thing where I have many, many, many endemic type things. So let's say I have 1 million people a year die of malaria, okay? So what is the incremental cost of the next life saved per dollar, right? This concept of dollar per life lost works horrible for things that are rare but in society, right? Well, how do you put a value on society? Or cost of 1 billion people dying is not the same as a few hundred thousand people a year for, 10,000 years, right? In the same way that you could argue that we lose 50,000 people a year in car accidents, right? But 3,000 people at once in the World Trade Center in 9/11 had a far larger impact on society, right? So that's why the people who really look at disasters, who really do modeling of risk, basically throw this idea of cost per life out and say, that's just stupid, okay? That applies to things like disease prevention, comparing curing malaria to curing dengue fever. Works great for those two things. But the second you start talking about super catastrophic things that change society, You need a whole different formulation. And so what they do is they throw that out, or they either say, mathematically what they do is they say a constraint that says, I can't let anything larger than this happen ever, or with greater than some certain probability, and then I maximize my distribution of what I do, my effect, with these constraints. Example is nuclear weapons. We spend an extraordinary amount of money to keep our nuclear weapons from exploding in their silos. Okay? Far larger, by many, many orders of magnitude, than you would if you were looking at average lives lost. Doesn't make sense from average lives lost. But it makes sense because the political and social and economic effects of having a nuclear weapon go off in a silo are so bad that the basic dollar per life lost is just a stupid thing to do. Stupid way to make a decision.
Yes, but I was thinking less of the Mile Wide event and more of your one Hiroshima bomb. And it brings to mind the high costs people are prepared to pay to stop a civil nuclear accident happening. Mm-hmm. If you translate, I agree with you that
But
it's not highway deaths, but if you look at how much is put into civil nuclear engineering to prevent cancer cases, does it look cheap compared to that?
Oh, incredibly cheap compared to that.
That would be a benchmark.
Actually, it turns out to be fairly cheap, period. So even if you do assume that you use it, it actually turns out to be a good deal. And here's the reason why. Your chances of dying in an airplane crash are roughly the same as your chances of dying due to an asteroid impact. Okay, and why is that? Because about once every million years, you lose 1 billion people. Okay, so you do the math, and it turns out to be about your odds of dying in a plane crash. Okay, and then if you ask how much money we spend on things like plane crashes, it's 1,000 times more than this. Okay, aviation safety is a huge deal. Okay, so it does. You can do the calculation. You do find it's favorable, but I'm arguing that it's just a bad calculation to make. Even if it shows that it's favorable, it's the wrong way to do it.
I just thought if you compared it with other bad calculations, you'd be looking pretty good.
It has been done, and everyone knows it's trash. So let's put it that way. Anyone seriously looking at risk says right up front, this is not the way to look at it. It's not the way to look at, you should put it in the category of all-out nuclear war.
And emotionally, people will pay a very high price for that protection. So yeah, but it makes your project look even cheaper.
Yeah, I would argue that we should spend a lot more money on this. That's true.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
So I'm curious about the detectable range of the asteroids mm-hmm. in your mission, and then as a follow-up, assuming that you wouldn't be able to detect everything that's in the sky, I'm curious how long you personally would have to be in operation before you'd breathe a sigh of relief.
Okay. The basic mission is 6.5 years, and that was picked because that really gets you the great majority of, we think we can find with 90% likelihood anything that's going to hit the Earth large enough to destroy a city after 6.5 years. That's how it was worked out. So yes, you are correct. The smaller they get, the longer it takes to find them all, because there are so many more of them. My contention is if it's smaller than Tunguska, it's going to be hard to... Most of those are actually going to explode high in the atmosphere, won't cause deaths on the ground. So let's concentrate on something that would certainly cause deaths on the ground if it hit.
Thank you.
It's
up
to you, but maybe 3 more. Okay, we'll take 3 more, and then we'll close up, let everybody go home.
I have a question about the... Your mission is for asteroid. What about the comet? Because I know 20 years ago, the famous impact on Jupiter. Mm-hmm. So it's much bigger than...
Yes. And we talked about comets earlier. Uh-huh. Comets are much harder to spot. This will not find comets. And nobody has a good way to find comets. But there's only 1% as many comets as there are asteroids. So they're just different problems to solve. And we cannot solve comets, we freely admit that, but asteroids are 100 times more likely to hit the Earth than comets.
So that means that we need another project.
Yeah, so after you finish this project, it makes sense to think about comets.
Mm-hmm. I have a non-technical question. As I understood, you started working on asteroids as a hobby, and now you're doing it as full-time profession. And you mentioned building observatory on the ground has a lot of influence from private sectors, and doing space mission from private sectors is not quite conventional, as I understood, it's mostly supported by governments for NASA, and everywhere around the world is by governments. So my question to you is, what it take for you to convert your hobby into profession, and you have, if you have any suggestions or opinions for young folks in the audience for doing this kind of thing, that would be great.
Yeah, what it took me to convert from this being something I was just interested in, something that I'm doing as a job, is being a little bit crazy. I think, you know, it's difficult. It's a lot of work, right? And believe me, it's a big pay cut from when I was working at Google. But sometimes it takes crazy people to get things done. That, you know, I you can't be scared of doing something crazy. If everybody was, you know, most people aren't going to go off and do something crazy. But somewhere, somebody needs to do that, because that's how progress is made. That's the way I feel, at least. And why don't we take the last two, and then we'll
call it. I gather from what you said that there must be absolute swarms of micrometeorites in orbit around the Earth. What were the odds that the space station and you on your spacewalk would have been impacted by one of these?
Well, the space station was hit many times by small micrometeorites while I was there. We had holes in the, there are holes in the arrays and so on. In fact, the best estimate is that over the lifetime of the space station, 15, 20 years, that the space station has about a 10% chance of having something come through it. And that's why every other month we did a depressurization drill on the space station of how we would close off hatches and so on if a hole got punched in one of the modules. So you know, the two biggest fears on a space station are fire and depressurization. And we alternated our emergency drill each month.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. My question is about the size of objects that the mission would be able to detect, and what's the lower limit of objects, and is that based on the technical ability, or is it just decision that you don't have to worry about things below a certain
megatonnage? It's both. The telescope doesn't have a minimum size that you can find, because the closer something is, the smaller it is that I can see it, right? You know, large objects I can see from further away. So really the proper way to state the question is, how long does it take to find all of them of a certain size? Okay, so the smaller you get, the longer it takes for you to find them all. All right, so really what we did was we sized the system such that the asteroids, the size that we cared about, we thought we would see all in a reasonable period of time. So it's not, it just means that we will still see smaller asteroids than that. It's just that we won't necessarily see them all. It depends on how long the telescope lasts before it dies. And it's very difficult to predict how long a spacecraft will run for. So, that size is 45 meters. It's about the size of the one landed over Tunguska. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much for an enlightening and also scary talk. I hope we all take...
It's supposed to be scary.
No, I think a little bit it's supposed to be scary, because this is excellent work that needs to be done. Thank you all for coming, and we'll see you hopefully on April 8th.